So this is the sixth and last of our classes in the Onto This Day study, where we were looking at that phrase, onto this day, and matching it up against 2 Timothy 3:16, that all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, truly furnished onto all good works. We looked at the idea of the inspiration of scripture in our class one, matching it up against the story of the creation of Samaria. We compared 2 Kings 17:41 with John 4:22 to show that the Father had specifically called the Samaritans, even though they worshipped in ignorance. They were specifically called. In 2 Kings 17, it says, "So these nations feared the Lord and served their graven images, both their children and their children's children, as did their fathers unto this day." And for those of you that were here for the class or heard the class, you know that the key to understanding as far as the inspiration of Scripture is that the great revelation of this is the only person that would have understood 2 Kings 17, it was the Lord Jesus Christ. That the Lord Father had spoken him specifically, even though some author centuries before had written it, that it was only Jesus that would have understood that was speaking to him, that he had to go through Samaria. Remember the quote from John 4, "I must needs go through Samaria." And so the Father sent him to Samaria because, as it says in John 4, verse 22 and 23, "The hour cometh and now is when the true worshippers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father seeketh such to worship him." And remember, we said that they were worshiping in truth, in sincerity, without an understanding of truth, and yet the Jews were worshiping, understanding the truth, and had no sincerity, and that's why they hated each other. So that was our first class about the inspiration of Scripture and about the lesson of Samaria. In our second class, we looked at the profitability of doctrine, and we considered the story of the naming of Beersheba onto this day, and the wonderful doctrine that the Lord's will is done through his servants, even at times when the servants themselves don't even know it. So we looked at the story of Isaac and how he was mad at Ahithophel because they kept taking the wells, and it was his friend Ahuzath that came and told him and reminded him that he was the servant of the Lord, that the Lord's will was being done through Isaac. And so that's where we considered the profitability of doctrine in that marvelous story about Beersheba, which is still called Beersheba to this day, and as far as the world is concerned, will always be called Beersheba, because the covenant that God made with Isaac was forever. That family, the Isaac, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, would be his servants, and they have always been her servants, even though they've often been his servants in disobedience. Yet still, the Lord's will, as we see today, is still being done through the Jews. In class three, we looked at correction and reproof, and we looked at the rolling away of the reproach of Egypt with the story of Gilgal, and how Gilgal was named Gilgal onto this day, and that day being the day that the stone was rolled away from the tomb, that we could look in and see the resurrected Christ. We're going to be considering a little bit more of that idea again today as we look at the Jews, because they've never accepted that stone being rolled away meant that their Christ was raised from the dead. And so we'll consider that. But that was class three, about the story of Gilgal and the correction and reproof that they received in the wilderness and before they crossed over the Jordan River. And we had said at the time that we're going to come back to the crossing of the Jordan later, and that's what we're going to look. One of the things we're going to look at today. In class four, we looked at the halting of Jacob's thigh, how it says that the children of Israel will not eat that sinew unto this day, and we used it as an expression of instruction in righteousness. The righteousness was that Jacob was not going to be judged. He was not going to be held accountable for his sin, because he was the servant of the Lord, and because his sin was covered not by him, but by another, which is where the next class took us when we looked at the perfection process. We considered last week the process of perfection that people come to, and we were comparing two pillars. We compared the pillar at Bethel that Jacob ends up pouring the water upon, that he took from the well in Shechem, the well that the woman of Samaria mentions to Jesus centuries later. And that water is living water. It's the recognition of Jacob as he poured that water onto that pillar, that his Redeemer would be the living truth, that he was a servant of God, but that perfection was not being perfected through him, but would be perfected through another. And then he goes to on his way to Ephrath, and Rachel dies. Rachel is the reflection of natural Israel, or Jacob struggling with God. And he buries his wife, and he builds a pillar to her death. And in that pillar, it says, it's there unto this day. And we looked at that fascinating story about the fact that it is, in fact, still there today, remarkably enough. But it's still there because that thing is still dead. That the whole trusting in yourself, the whole idea that Rachel had, that it was all about natural things and not spiritual things. Jacob took that whole thing and buried it in the ground. And when he buried it in the ground, remember it says that Jacob buried his wife and built the pillar, and then Israel traveled on. And it says, and he spread his tent beyond the Tower of Edah. And so we consider that in the perfection process. And today, what we're going to look at is, where Paul says that all scripture is profitable, that the man of God may be thoroughly furnished unto all good works. We've talked quite a bit about the recognition of the redeemed, that we have been redeemed by the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. And we know that he learned obedience by the things that he suffered, and that he poured out his life in obedience to the Father, perfecting forever the word of truth. We understand, because we've looked at it, how shame enslaves us, but by the power of the resurrection we can be freed from the sin of the world and free from the shame that we try to cover up. We looked at that quite a bit when we were looking at the story of the wilderness wanderings and the story of Gilgal, and how we want to cover up our sin. And that shame is what leads us to want to cover. We're going to see another example of that again today. But now what we have is a burning desire within us to serve God in sincerity, or in spirit, in truth. But how do we do it? Can we do it? And let's consider for a moment what James's words are in James chapter 1. And I have it there up on the screen if you want to punch it up. It's James chapter 1, verse 25. And he's talking about the perfect law of liberty. And that's really what we're given by the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. Is we're given the perfection of Christ, the perfect law of liberty, the freedom from sin. We talked quite a bit about the difference between a sincere faith and an enlightened faith. A sincere faith is somebody who looks down to see up, somebody who sincerely wants his sins forgiven, but whose faith is about what Paul said when he said, "O wretched man that I am," and that constant feeling like I'm never good enough, I'm never, it's all about my sin. And that's what a sincere faith is all about. It's all about my sin. And you can turn to the Bible and always see messages of a sincere faith, because it is a part of faith. But what we talked about is an enlightened faith. The fact that there's a law of liberty, the fact that there is freedom from sin. And and when we free ourselves from sin, then we can look up and see the glory of God. Remember, we looked at that story of the blind man that Jesus heals in Mark 5. And the first time he sees the men tall like trees when Jesus first clears his eyes. And then Jesus has him look up. And then he sees men as they are. And that's really what happens when we look up and see the glory of God. We don't just see the glory of God, but we see men for what they really are, both ourselves and all men, all mankind. And that's what the glory of God is all about, is recognizing that all things are done for God's purpose. All things aren't done for our salvation. They're done for God's purpose. Our salvation is a marvelous byproduct of the plan and purpose of God. But it is the glorification of God that is the ultimate purpose of God. And so when we look at the story today about good works, the good works are going to be about glorifying God. And how do we get to that point of glorifying our Father, which is in heaven? So look what it says in James chapter 5. It said, "Whoso looketh unto the perfect law of liberty and continueth therein, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deed." So this idea of looking onto the law of liberty is exactly what we've been doing for 6 weeks. And in point of fact, it's what we do every single day as we try to both overcome sin, but also see God's plan and purpose. It's the marvelous aspect of our faith. It's what separates so much of our faith from other religions, that it's all about being saved from your sins. And obviously being saved from your sins is important. But there's a reason why Numbers 14:21 is so important to us, and not really recognized by a lot of other people as an important verse. It is the center of the plan and purpose of God. And yet, you know, that's all the earth shall be filled with the glory of the Lord. And it's at the heart of God's message. And our faith, we can see that. We are blessed to have a faith that allows us to see enlightened things. It doesn't necessarily mean that we will see enlightened things, but we are blessed to have the ability to see enlightened things. And so we look unto the perfect law and liberty. Then it says, and continueth therein, meaning we don't go back. We don't go back to sincere Christianity every time we hit a bump in the road. Now, it's when we sin, that's what sin does. Sin brings us back into that mentality of, oh, I can't believe I've done it again. I can't believe I've fallen again. And that natural inclination that Adam and Eve have and that we all have to then cover up that sin. Right? But the law of liberty says don't fall back into that. And the reason why you don't fall back into that is because Christ has been nailed to the cross and has nailed that to the cross. Remember, it says he endured the cross despising the shame, rejecting the shame. Because the shame is what keeps pulling you back down. So we're going to look at that again in a little while. And it says, not being a forgetful hearer. Well, we've heard it. We've heard a lot of liberty. And we know how Abraham was blessed, despite the fact he was living a lie. Remember, we saw that Abraham in Egypt became rich, became wealthy. And yet the whole time he was in Egypt, and remember, we looked at how the Lord kept appearing to him and blessing him. And yet the entire time he was blessing him, Abraham was living a lie. And the lie he was living was that he was calling his wife his sister. Right? Now, it's a white lie because he was his half-sister, but it was a lie. And then when he's finally called out to task for it by Ahimelech, Abraham says, you know, I've been living that lie ever since I came out of Ur of Chaldees. And yet the Lord has been blessing him. And that's the law of liberty. Remember, we start with Isaac. When Ahuzath comes down and says to him, have you forgotten who you are? And Isaac is like, I have forgotten who I was. And yet the Lord's will was still being done. That's the whole point about the well, finding water. And we saw it most especially with Jacob. Because remember, Jacob struggles with the angel. He's been struggling his entire life with God. And when he struggles with the angel and he recognizes not only that he's not going to beat the angel, but the angel's not going to beat him, remember, we talked about that idea of him being snatched away. He was snatched away from judgment. And he recognized when he was snatched away from judgment that he had no right to be snatched away from judgment based upon his own righteousness, because he didn't have any. And we pointed out that the one who was truly snatched away was the Lord Jesus Christ. Remember, we looked at Jacob, and he had one bone knocked out of joint. The Lord Jesus Christ on the cross had all of his bones, a complete sacrifice, a total lifetime sacrifice. That's why Jacob could recognize that there was another. And this is what, again, what the law of liberty is all about. And Lord willing, I'm going to see it again as well. It says, but a doer of the work. And that liberty that we have been given should compel us to act if we truly recognize the magnitude of what God has done for us and how can we not act upon it. Do you realize how much time has been done in the spiritual family every day? Often we don't see it, and sadly we don't do it because we get bogged down in all of our old fears. And it says, this man shall be blessed in his deeds. Well, what does deeds mean? It doesn't mean work. Deeds are what we do to glorify God. Work is what we do for ourselves. The word deeds means doings. One of the things that I stress all the time, you know, I went around New England and I talked about the Bible school. And I said, you get so much more out of Bible school if you get involved. Not because you get credit for what you did, but because you are blessed for doing it. You are strengthened in your faith by doing acts by getting involved. And that's what the perfect law of liberty is all about. That's what drives you to get involved, is the fact that God has saved you from your sins through Jesus Christ. We don't get involved because we have a responsibility. Now that we've been baptized, we have to do this. If that were true, then there would be no real blessings from it. It would just be a chore. But it's not a chore. It's strengthening your faith every day by the things that you do. These six classes, which Jack pointed out, I've done four times now. Every time I do them, I get more out of doing them than you ever get by hearing them. Especially you poor souls that have heard them two or three times. Trust me, I get so much more out of putting these things together, because there's always more to learn, because there's always more to praise God, to bring God's praise to you. So the conclusion of this is, as we consider the story of the Valley of Achor, we're going to see that there are two remarkable acts of good works, one by an incredibly faithful man, and another by a man who had little to no faith at all. And yet, both acts glorify God. And when they glorify God, then the idea that God is all in all becomes stronger in their mind and in ours. So that's what we're going to look at with this story about the story of Achan. So it's found in Joshua chapter, the verse we're going to consider, or the onto this day verse that we're going to look at, is found in Joshua chapter 7. And I've got it punched up here. And it says in chapter 7, verse 26, and it's talking about Achan. And it says, "And they raised over him a heap of stones unto this day. So the Lord turned from the fierceness of his anger, wherefore the name of that place was called the Valley of Achor unto this day." So notice there's actually two. So we get two for the price of one unto this day today. And in actual fact, we're going to come across two other passages that talk about onto this day, and they're all actually talking about the exact same day, interestingly enough, as we look closer at it, or the exact same, no, the exact same day. So onto what day is it talking about? Well, take a look at the second one first. It says, "The Valley of Achor shall be called the Valley of Achor onto this day." Well, we've already considered the idea of the day being the day the author wrote the message. And we've tossed that out because all scripture is profitable. And we have no idea when the writer of Joshua 7 wrote Joshua 7. So it's really meaningless for us to consider that the onto this day is being talked about was the day the author wrote it. Now that was probably what the author meant when he wrote it. But that's not the message. That's not the profitability of the message. So what day is it talking about? Is it talking about today? Right? Because when we looked at Beersheba is still called Beersheba today, right? So is that the day that, in fact, the pillar, Rachel's pillar, is still there today? Well, there is no place in the land of Israel called the Valley of Achor today. In fact, there's never been a place called the Valley of Achor except in the time of Joshua. That's the only time period ever that anything was ever called the Valley of Achor. So we'll come back to the idea of what day is being talked about. But first I want to ask the question, where would this Valley of Achor be? Well, that we can figure out fairly well. So here on this map, you'll see I have the Valley of Achor. It's actually, you see where that bubble is? Let me put an arrow to it. And there's where the Valley of Achor is, according to interpretations of the period of time that we're looking at in Joshua 7. It was located most assuredly near Jericho in one of two places, either just northeast of it or just southeast of Jericho. Either way, so it was either there or it was there. Either way, it looks pretty much like this. Now, here's the interesting thing about it. You see, it says a place for herds to lie down in. That comes from Isaiah chapter 65. The name the Valley of Achor is found five times. It's found twice here in this record of the stoning of Achan. It's found once in Joshua 15, when that part of the book of Joshua lays out the boundaries. And in the boundaries of the tribe of Judah, it mentions the Valley of Achor as being part of the boundaries. It's never mentioned again, except it's mentioned twice in prophecy. And once in one of the prophecies that it's mentioned in is Isaiah 65 in verse 10. And it says this. This is in Isaiah 65, verse 10. "And Sharon shall be a fold of flocks, and the Valley of Achor a place for the herds to lie down in, for my people that have sought me." Now this picture here is what the two areas, doesn't matter whether you're northeast or southeast of Jericho, where they presume Jericho is, and our brother Lean Littmeyer has found Jericho, so we have a good idea where it is. Actually, I think it was
an associated liens that found it, actually. But this is more or less what it looks like in that entire area. And notice, Isaiah says, it shall be a fold of flocks in the valley of Achor, a place for the herds to lie down in, for those who have sought me. Well, that doesn't really look like a place for herds to lie down in any way, shape, or form. It's a pretty barren, desolate area that we're talking about. The other place that it's found is in Hosea chapter 2, verse 15. And it says there, and again, these are prophetic statements. So it's talking about a place to come. It says, and I will give her her vineyards from thence, and the valley of Achor for a door of hope, and she shall sing there as in the days of her youth, and as in the days when she came out of the land of Egypt. So it's called a place for a doorway of hope where she shall sing. Well, this hardly looks like a doorway of hope. And yet it is prophetic. What is being said. Prophecy clearly expresses that this barren land will be a place of comfort. Notice that this prophecy says that the day is coming when they shall sing in the place as in the day that she came up out of Egypt. Well, when would that be that they would have sung? Well, I want you to open up to Joshua chapter 5, because we're being talked specifically about a certain period of time. In Joshua chapter 5, if you go and look up this idea of in my youth, what it's talking here about when it says, in the day that she came out of the land of Egypt, this Achan is the door of hope, when they crossed across the Jordan and came into the valley of Achor, that's where, when we looked at it with Gilgal, that they performed the circumcision. Remember, they performed the circumcision the second time, and we looked at quite a bit at that. Well, one of the things that they did during that time, before the sin of Achan, is they held a Passover. You find it in Joshua chapter 5, in verse 10. And it says, and the children of Israel camped in Gilgal, that's right by the valley of Achor, and kept the Passover on the 14th day of the month at the even in the plains of Jericho. So they kept a Passover. Well, one of the things you do at Passover is you sing the songs of deliverance. It's part of the rite, part of the ritual of Passover, is you sing the songs of deliverance. It was the first Passover that had been held since they were in Sinai. So we're talking about the crossing, the period where they crossed the Jordan and come into the Valley of Achor and come into where Gilgal is. So it's been 39 years since they were in Sinai, because remember, they were in Sinai just a few months after coming out of Egypt. And this is 40 years, really. So this is 40 years later. So for 40 years, they didn't hold the Passover. So for 40 years, there was no singing. And now here in Joshua chapter 5, in between the period of time that they cross into this area and before Achan sins, they hold the Passover. So that's what Hosea is talking about, where it says, a doorway of hope, and she shall sing there, as in the days of her youth, as in the day when she came out of the land of Egypt. Well, what day is being talked about where this prophecy is going to take place, where they're going to sing songs again, songs of deliverance? Well, that's the day that we want to look into. So in order to look into it, we want to go back to something that we said a few weeks ago. I said we were going to go back to, and that is, are you going to switch over? The crossing of the Jordan. So turn back a page to Joshua chapter 3. And we're going to cross the Jordan with Joshua and that new generation. Remember, Moses died on the east side of the Jordan. All the others have died. All the first generation has died in the wilderness. And now that second generation that we mentioned back a few years ago, that it says Joshua had raised up in the stead of their parents, because the parents did not raise them up properly, because they spent 39 years just moaning and complaining in the wilderness and didn't take care of their own kids, didn't hold a Passover, didn't perform circumcision, didn't do any of that kind of stuff. And we talked about how Joshua raised them up through as God's representative. So God raised them up, but Joshua was the one that had the Bible class. that taught him what all the messages of the wilderness was supposed to be and who Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob was and all of that. We're going to pick it up in verse 1 of Joshua chapter 3. And we're about to cross the Jordan River. And Joshua rose up early in the morning, and they removed from Shittim and came to Jordan. He and all the children of Israel lodged there before they passed over. And it came to pass after 3 days that the officers went through the host. And they commanded the people, saying, when you see the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God, and the priests and the Levites bearing it, then you shall remove from your place and go after it. Yet there shall be a space between you and about 2,000 cubits by measure. Come not near unto it, that ye may know that the way by which you must go, for you have not passed this way heretofore. So Joshua says to him, all right, the ark is going to go first, and you're going to follow the ark 2,000 cubits away from it, so that you know that you've not passed this way before. Well, that's kind of an interesting statement. I mean, obviously they haven't passed this way before. I mean, they know they haven't crossed the Jordan River before. So why would Joshua say to them, you know, so that you'll know that we haven't crossed this way before? Well, I believe there's two reasons. And the first reason is because Joshua doesn't want them to look back. Or Joshua doesn't want them to see that this is the same as what happened before, because they had crossed before, right? They had crossed the Red Sea, right, when they came out of Egypt. And Joshua wanted them to understand this crossing is not the same crossing as the crossing of the Red Sea. When you were baptized, remember it says they were baptized into Moses. This isn't that same crossing. So what's the difference? Well, let's take a look. Oh, there's that passage. So here on the screen, what I have is, and I'm sorry that you guys here can't see it, but I can tell you exactly what it is. It's a comparison between what happened at the crossing of the Red Sea and what this crossing is here. So let me read to you the two passages. So here's how in Exodus 14, verse 21, you have the crossing of the Red Sea. And I'm going to pick it up in verse 21 and read verse 22. And Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord caused the sea to go back by a strong east wind all that night, and made the sea dry land, and the waters were divided. And the children of Israel went into the midst of the sea upon dry ground, and the waters were a wall unto them, unto their right hand and unto their left. So turn back. You know what? We will go back to Exodus for a moment. Turn back to Exodus 14. There's something else I want to point out, and we'll point out the rest of that in just a minute. And look what it says in verse 19. So you know the story if you've ever seen, you know, Charlton Heston and the Ten Commandments, or you've ever read, you know the story, right? You know they come to the Red Sea, and you know they've got a pillar and a cloud, and the pillar's been leading them through to the Red Sea. But as the Egyptians start to come to them, read verse 9, see what it says in verse 19. It says, and the angel of God, which went before the camp of Israel, removed and went behind them. And the pillar and the cloud went from before their face and stood behind them. Now pick it up on verse 21. And Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord caused the sea to go back by a strong east wind all that night, and made the sea dry land and the waters thereof. And the children of Israel went into the midst of the sea upon dry ground. So at Exodus, God did not go before them into the sea. And Moses, it doesn't say, went before them into the sea, right? It says Moses raises his hand and the sea parted. And then the children of Israel went into the sea. So God's pillar and God's angel was behind them, protecting them from the Egyptians. And they went into the sea, and presumably Moses went into the sea with them. But it says nothing about, you know, Moses being 2,000 cubits away or any of that kind of stuff, or going first. They all went in before them, and the protection was behind them. Well, look at the difference between that. Oh, and also, you know the difference from a water perspective, right? So when they cross the Red Sea, they're crossing a sea. So the waters part, and you had a wall of water on the left, and you had a wall of water on the right as they crossed the Red Sea. But that's not what happens when they crossed the Jordan River, because you're crossing a river. So let's go back again to Joshua chapter 3, and we'll pick it up in verse 6. And notice the difference. And Joshua spake unto the priests, and saying, take up the Ark of the Covenant, and pass over before the people. And they took over up the Ark of the Covenant, and went before the people. Verse 14. And it came to pass, when the people removed their tents to pass over the Jordans, and the priests bearing the Ark of the Covenant before the people. And as they bare the Ark were come into the Jordan, and the feet of the priests that bare the Ark were dipped into the brim of the water, for the Jordan overfloweth its banks all the time of harvest, that the waters which came down from above stood and rose up upon a heap far from the city of Adam, that is beside Zaratan. And those that came down toward the sea of the plain, even the salt sea, failed and were cut off, and all the people passed over against Jericho. And the priests that bare the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord stood on dry ground in the midst of the Jordan, and all the Israelites passed over on dry ground until the people were passed over Jordan. So, in this case, what happens is the Ark goes before the people. And when the priest's foot touched the waters part. And the water that was south just flowed down into the Dead Sea. And the water that was north backed up to the city of Adam. So you didn't have two walls of water. Picture that? Yeah, there it is. You didn't have two walls. It was hard, actually, to find a picture of this, by the way. Because every picture you have shows them carrying the Ark and showing two walls of water on either side. That's not what it was. It was literally, it was them walking in on dry ground and one set of water going away and the other thing backing up about 20 miles back. And they walked into the midst and they walked 2,000 cubits. They were kept 2,000 cubits away from the children of Israel. So what Joshua was saying to them is, this isn't the same thing. In the other case, you were protected as you cross the Red Sea. In this case, you're led across the Jordan. Can you see the difference? So he wants to make sure that they know that. And he's telling them that for a specific reason. Because this is not the same type of passing. Because that passing was baptism into Moses, baptism into the law. This is a different crossing. This is a crossing where you're crossing across the Jordan River. And remember, the Jordan River starts in Mount Hermon, the mountain of life, flows through the abundant Sea of Galilee, and then leads down into the Dead Sea. That is the passage of life, from Mount Hermon to the Dead Sea. And what happens here is that life is cut off. That life that we all know of mortal flesh that goes from life down to death is cut off right here at this crossing. At this crossing, the waters stop. And you are passing, you are cutting off death in figure through this crossing. It's been cut off. And notice where it's cut off to. It's cut off to all the way back to Adam. So you see, this is a foreshadowing of the great sacrifice of Jesus Christ that cuts off that will of the flesh. So that's what's going on here. So we're told that the river of Jordan is cut off. We know what the river represents. We're told that the ark goes before them. We know what the ark represents. We know that the ark represents Christ. He is the ark, right? There's life in that ark. Eternal life is in that ark. So we know that the ark represents Christ. We know that he's the one that cuts off from life to death. He's the one that cuts that off through his sacrifice. And that sacrifice covers everything all the way back to Adam. All the way back to that point where Adam and Eve sinned and you had the crushing of the head of the serpent back in Genesis 3:16. So there is all this going on about looking back at the Red Sea and recognizing that this is different and looking forward. Can you see what that is? Now, what did the people of Israel know? Well, they probably didn't know all the aspects. In fact, you can be assured that they didn't know all the aspects of what this crossing represented. But they would have known some. they certainly would have been able to see the difference between the Red Sea crossing and this crossing, as far as what was happening with the waters, as far as the ark leading them forward. But notice that we're told that point about 2,000 cubits. So why are we told 2,000 cubits? And that they would not have understood. Why the ark had to be 2,000 cubits, why they had to remain 2,000 cubits separate. Actually, it says about 2,000 cubits separate from the ark. And it's because it's a relationship to 2,000 years. Because the true cutting off for the children of Israel is going to take place 2,000 years later from the one who cuts it off literally. The 2,000 years represents the time when Christ cuts off the Jordan River to the times when the Jews finally accept Jesus Christ as their Savior. Or this particular aspect of Jews, which I'll explain in a minute. Now, they wouldn't have known that. But there is somebody there who definitely knows that. Take a look what happens. We're going to pick it up in chapter 4, verse 1 of Joshua. It says, "And when it came to pass, when all the people were clean passed over Jordan, that the Lord spake unto Joshua, saying, Take ye 12 men out of the people of the tribe, every tribe a man. And so the Lord tells Joshua to get it, to take men. So it's the Lord telling Joshua to do this. "And command them, saying, Take ye hence out of the midst of the Jordan, out of the place where the priest's feet stood firm, 12 stones. And ye shall carry them over with you, and leave them in the lodging place where you shall lodge this night." Then he takes the 12 people, pick it up in verse 5. "And Joshua said unto them, Pass over before the ark of the Lord." And so they do that. And then verse 6. "That this may be a sign among you, that when your children ask their fathers in time to come, saying, What mean ye by these stones? Then ye shall answer them, that the waters of Jordan were cut off before the ark of the covenant of the Lord, when it passed over Jordan, and the waters of Jordan were cut off. And these stones shall be a memorial unto the children of Israel forever." So these are the stones. So he says, go to where the priest stood, take 12 stones, go to the west side of the Jordan, and build this pillar, if you will. Build this stone memorial. And for generations, when people say, what are those stones about? You'll say, those are the stones from the midst of the Jordan that the Lord told us to put over here to remember that the ark sat in the midst of the Jordan. Now, it says there that this is a covenant forever at the verse 7. So are those stones still there today? And if they are there, would they be visible? Well, they would be visible, right? They're sitting there by the side of the Jordan River. Presumably, they would be visible. I could find nothing that shows that those stones are still there. But the story is still there. Here's the story in the book, right? So we know the story is still there, the story of these stones. But look what happens next. Verse 8 says, And the children did as Joshua commanded and took the 12 stones, and so they did it. And then look at verse 9. "And Joshua set up 12 stones in the midst of the Jordan, in the place where the feet of the priests which bear the Ark of the Covenant stood, and they are there unto this day." So, remember we said God told him to get people to take 12 stones out of the middle of the river and put them on the west side of the river and build something as a memorial. And they do it. And this is what Joshua does. Joshua then takes 12 stones himself, goes into the Jordan where the priest stood, and builds an identical pillar where the priest stood in the midst of the Jordan. And it says, and they are there unto this day. He's not told to do it. So why does he do it? Well, there's two questions. Actually, there's two questions. First of all, why did he do it? And secondly, it says, they're there unto this day. How would you know? Right, there's no way. They're in the middle of the Jordan River. I would say, no matter what day you're talking about, here's our third use of that verse, onto this day, by the way. But how would you know they were there? There's no way to tell that they were there. So then why did Joshua do it? If he's not told to do it, and there's no way you could tell. And it's a witness. It's a witness unto this day. Unto what day? That's the day we're going to come to. He puts 12 stones in the middle of the river because he knows somebody's going to come across this river again, and those stones will be there. So when does that happen? So let's continue on. And that's the story of the stones in the river. Now come over again to Joshua chapter 7. And we'll continue. Oh, there is the verse of Joshua chapter 4. I just get my notes caught up if I could. And we're going to come to Joshua chapter 7. And it says in verse 1. Now, so they cross over. We know the story of Gilgal. We know what happens there. We know Jericho is there. We know they have the Battle of Jericho. And we know as far as Joshua knows, everything's fine. And then they go fight Ai, and they have the whole problem at Ai where they lose the battle. And then Joshua finds out that something has happened at Jericho. So Joshua chapter 7, verse 1. And the children of Israel committed a trespass in the accursed thing. For Achan, the son of Carmi, the son of Zabdi, the son of Zerah, the son of Judah, took of the accursed thing, and the anger of the Lord was kindled against the children of Israel. So notice, first of all, that it says that the children of Israel committed this sin. It doesn't say that Achan, Achan is the one that does it, obviously, but Achan is representative of the children of Israel. And we're going to see that again later on. But it's Achan that does it. So they go into Jericho. They've had this great experience at Gilgal where they've all been circumcised, including Achan. They've all crossed the Jordan River, including Achan, and then they go into Jericho, and he sees something that's good, and he takes it. Pick it up in verse 16. So they obviously lose the battle of Ai. Joshua has a situation where he falls down, and the Lord says, get up. Obviously, something has happened, and so now Joshua is going to call out the roll, if you will. Verse 16, Joshua chapter 7. So Joshua rose up early in the morning and brought Israel by their tribes, and the tribe of Judah was taken. And he brought of the family of Judah, and he took the family of the Zerites, and so on and so forth. And he brought, in verse 18, and he brought his household man by man. And Achan, the son of Carmi, the son of Zabdi, the son of Zerah, the son of Judah was taken. By the way, I listened to a great talk one time, and I wish I could remember who it was because I tried to find it. That makes a suggestion that where it says, and he brought his household man by man, I think it was John Martin that said this, that his household is talking about Joshua's household. Even though Joshua was of the family of Ephraim, this is, of course, centuries later, and John Martin, now that I think about it, I'm sure it was John Martin, said that the family that Achan was a part of was Joshua's family. Which is an interesting thing because, you know, Joshua is called Joshua the son of Nun. And you'll find no descendants of Joshua. So he was not only the son of Nun, he was the father of Nun, as far as Scripture is concerned. And remember, Joshua's the guy that says, determine who you're going to serve, but for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. There's no record of any house of Joshua. You won't find it. And so John Martin makes the point that this is the family of Joshua, that it was Achan was the one family member of Joshua, and probably a very close family member. I can't prove it, but I put it out there as an interesting part, especially as we look at it further. Now pick it up in verse 19. And Joshua said unto Achan, my son, give, I pray thee, glory to the Lord God of Israel, and make confession unto him, and tell me now what thou hast done. Hide it not from me. And Achan answered Joshua and said, indeed, I have sinned against the Lord God of Israel, and thus have I done. When I saw among the spoils a godly Babylonish garment and 2 shekels of silver and a wedge of gold and 50 shekels by weight, then I coveted them and took them, and behold, they are hid in the earth in the midst of my tent, and the silver under. So Joshua says, he calls out Achan, and he says, calls him my son. Don't know if that is because, remember, Joshua would have been the guy that raised him up in his family's stead, or because he was literally a relative of his. But he says, give an honest confession. Give glory to God is specifically what he says. And look what Achan does. I mean, he does. He's done a terrible thing, right? But he does give an honest confession. If nothing else, he gives a true and honest confession, because they go to his house and they dig it up, and sure enough, they find everything that he says. Everything is there. So let's pick it up down the line. We'll pick it up in verse 24. It says, Joshua and all Israel with him took Achan the son of Zerah and the silver and the garments and the wedge of gold and his sons and his daughters and his oxen and his axes and his sheep and his tent and all that he had and brought them onto the valley of Achor. So basically he took what he stole, his sons and daughters and all of his possessions and livestock, and he took them down into the valley of Achor. And Joshua said, this is verse 25, Joshua chapter 7. Why hast thou troubled us? Now, the name Achan, by the way, means troubler. So you've got this extremely dramatic event, needless to say, where the entire nation, people of Israel, you know, just days from crossing over into the promised land, are going to take this entire family and everything that they have, and they're going to kill him. And he says to him, why hast thou troubled us? The Lord shall trouble thee this day. Well, doesn't it strike you as odd that he would play almost like a word game at this point in time with the drama that's going on here? Just some, and to say to him, we're going to trouble thee this day. Well, they're going to trouble him. They're going to stone him and burn him. They're going to trouble him. I mean, you see what I mean? It's a funny expression to use, but it has a very specific meaning and lesson that we'll see in just a few minutes. And it says, and all Israel stoned him with stones and then burned them with fire after they had stoned them with stones. So not only did they stone him to death, but then they took the entire thing and burned it into ashes. Makes you wonder why. I mean, if they stoned him to death, you know, it made me think of that line from The Wizard of Oz, you know, not just merely dead, but most sincerely really dead. It's like, you know, they're going to take it to the extreme that to say that this is how accursed and how horrible a thing that Achan has done. That not only are they going to stone everything that he owns and his sons and daughters and his livestock and everything else, but then they're going to burn the whole thing into ash. And then look what happens. And they raised over him a great heap of stones unto this day. So the Lord, I think that's what I have here next. I apologize, I felt a little bit. Yeah, I do. Okay. And the Lord turned from the fierceness of his anger, wherefore the name of the place was called the Valley of Achor, unto this day. So there is our unto this day there. So they take a heap of stones, and here I got my heap of stones in our picture here. Who knows if it's the same heap of stones, right? That whole area is all stone. So it says those stones are there on to this day. Okay, isn't that kind of a funny thing to say as well? Like the stones are there on to this day. I mean, you've killed the family and you've burned them into ashes and you've buried them. And then you pile a bunch of stones on top. Okay. And those stones are still there on to this day. So what? You know? He's been stoned. The whole thing has been stoned and burned down into ash. What difference does it make if the stones are still there or not there? Or, you know, it just seems awfully superfluous to say that those stones are still there to this day. And we can assume that they are, right? But first of all, how would you know where they are? And secondly, what difference does it make if they're there or not? They've been stoned and burned, you know? So what difference does it make? Well, it's going to make all the difference in the world. So let's continue with our story. So again, so what day is being talked about? And we mentioned the fact that Achan itself, there is no Valley of Achor today. If you looked at a map, you know, it wouldn't show you a Valley of Achor. Even the pictures that I showed you, it's something called Wadi Kelt, because nobody specifically knows exactly where it is, though they know that that's the area, and they know that's what it looks like. But it is mentioned, again, twice in Scripture. It's mentioned here again, just to show you again, and I got a little nicer picture. there than the first one. This picture is actually not from the Valley of Achor, because I wanted to find a picture that had some green in it. It says, "In Sharon shall be a fold of flocks, and the Valley of Achor a place for her to lie down in." So it's called the Valley of Achor, which that word Achor means trouble. So it's the valley. It's basically it's saying that the Valley of Trouble will be a place for herds to lie down in. So the Valley of Trouble is going to become a Valley of Peace. And then again in Hosea, it says, just to remind us, "And I will give her her vineyards from hence in the Valley of Achor," that is the Valley of Trouble, "for a door of hope. And she shall sing there," and so forth and so on. So you have the Valley of Trouble is prophetically going to become a Valley of Hope. So how is this going to happen? In order to understand that, we have to understand the role that this valley and those stones, as well as the stones that are in the midst of the Jordan, are going to play in latter-day prophecy, because that's what these two verses are talking about. They're prophetic verses about latter-day prophecy. And the first point that needs to be made is about references to the children of Israel in prophecy. So you probably recognize this verse. This comes from Zechariah 12, verse 7, and if you guys can't see it, I'll read it to you. It says, "The Lord shall save the tents of Judah first." So it's a prophecy about what is referred to as the tents of Judah. And in prophecy, so this is the point. It says that they're going to be saved first. And the reason why it says the tents of Judah are going to be saved first is to say that there's another tents, if you will, that are going to be saved second. And the children of Israel are going to be saved twice. The tents of Judah are going to be saved first. And then those that are referred to in prophecy as the remnant of Jacob, or as Ephraim, or as the house of Israel, are going to be saved second. That's why it says tents of Judah are going to be saved first. What the tents of Judah is a reference to are the Israelites living in the land at the time when Christ comes. So when you see Judah mentioned in prophecy, it's always talking about Jews living in the land, when you look at latter-day prophecy. So that's who Judah is. So we know the story of Jesus Christ coming to Mount Sinai at the time of Armageddon, and the Mount of Olives is split in two, and the children living in Israel are going to accept Jesus as their Messiah, right? Because they have to, because they're basically about to be destroyed, right? And Jesus saves them from the Gogian host. That is saving the tribes of Judah first. But that doesn't talk about the Jews who are not in the land of Israel. There's going to be a contingency of Jews in the land of Israel who will be saved by Jesus Christ at Armageddon. But there's a whole other contingency of Jews who are outside the land. And what happens to them? Well, they're saved second. And that's really what this story is all about. It's about the Jews outside the land in prophecy. And what happens to them? So let's look at a couple passages that show it. First of all, remember this passage here. We looked at this at the end of last week, and we said we were going to come back to it. And it's found in Jeremiah chapter 31. It says, "Thus saith the Lord, refrain thy voice from weeping." And remember, this is talking about Rachel, about natural Israel. Remember? And remember when Rachel was weeping? Because the two-year-old children were slaughtered. And remember, it talks about Rachel weeping because Israel is going into diaspora, going into trouble. And that's what Rachel represents, Israel in trouble, right? And it says this, "And thine eyes from tears, for thy work shall be rewarded, saith the Lord." That is the work of natural Israel for centuries upon centuries, as being those that carried the word of God, even though they've been doing it in disobedience. Even though and we've looked at all kinds of people who were in sin, and yet the Lord's purpose was being done. And the nation of Israel, both in the land and outside the land, represents the same thing. Because look what it says. I'm going to skip ahead, because it goes 16 and 17 in verse 34 of Jeremiah 31. "And there is hope in thine end." And we're talking about the Valley of Achor. You're right, Butchie, I'm running out of time. "Saith the Lord, that the children shall come again to their own border. For I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more." So it talks about the children of Israel coming back to the border. Well, the children of Judah are already in the land. But the children of Israel are going to come to the land again. And that's what's known as the wilderness of the peoples. So let me show you a couple verses that talk about the specifics of it. Turn over to Ezekiel chapter 20. And these are latter-day prophecies that talk about the return of the dispersed Jews back to Israel. We're going to look at just two or three, and I'll try to go as fast as I can. We're going to start in verse 27, just quickly to show you where we're at. This is Ezekiel 20, verse 27. I think I said 37, but I meant 27. It says, "Therefore, son of man, speak unto the house of Israel, and say unto them, Thus saith the Lord, Yet in this your fathers have blasphemed me, in that they have committed a trespass against me." And as I read these verses, I want you to consider the sin of Achan and how it plays out. We're going to look at Ezekiel 20, and then we're going to look at Jeremiah chapter 3. And just consider it in relation to Achan. So there you see it's talking about the house of Israel. So the house of Israel are the Jews outside the land. Pick it up in verse 33. "As I live, saith the Lord God, surely with a mighty hand and with an outstretched arm, with fury poured out, will I rule over you. And I will bring you out from the people, and will gather you out of the countries wherein ye are scattered, with a mighty hand and with an outstretched arm, and with fury poured out." So he says, I'm going to bring you back to the land. And it's not going to be an easy process, but I'm going to bring you back to the land. In verse 35, and it says, "I will bring you into the wilderness of the people, and there will I plead with you face to face. Like I have pleaded with your fathers in the wilderness of the land of Egypt, so I will plead with you, saith the Lord." So he's going to take them out of the land, and as he's bringing them back, he's going to plead with them. There's another verse that talks about providing teachers at that time. And they're going to be teachers teaching these people as they come out from the nations. And the nations aren't going to just let them go. There's going to be a battle to get these people back. Verse 37. "And I will cause you to pass under the rod, and I will bring you into the bond of the covenant. And I will purge out from among you the rebels and them that transgressed against me. And I will bring them forth out of the country wherein they sojourned. And they shall not enter into the land of Israel. And you shall know that I am the Lord." So what he's saying is, he's going to take these people, and he's going to take them out of their nations. And as they're traveling, they're going to have hardship. And he says, and I'm going to separate the rebels out. Those who are disobedient, those who refuse to accept the bond of the covenant. He's going to separate them out as they're traveling back to the land of Israel. And they're not going to enter into the land of Israel. That's what it says right there, right? "They shall not enter into the land of Israel, and ye shall know that I am the Lord." Now skip ahead to verse 43. It says there, and there, I think I'm going to use my little, there it is. Verse 43. "And there shall ye remember your ways and all your doings wherein ye have defiled. And ye shall loathe yourselves in your own sight for all your evil that ye have committed." Verse 44. "And ye shall know that I am the Lord when I have wrought with you for my name's sake, not according to your wicked ways, nor according to your corrupt doings, O ye house of Israel, saith the Lord." Now that has been the ongoing sort of underlying theme of everything we've talked about in these 6 weeks. That he's saying to them, look what it says. "And I shall know that I am the Lord when I have wrought with you for my name's sake, not according to your wicked ways." That's exactly what Abraham learned. That's exactly what Isaac learned. That's exactly what Jacob learned. That they weren't going to be held accountable for their sins. Because of the Lord's name's sake, nor according to your corrupt doings. And these are people who are now in the land. He's already separated out those that aren't going to be allowed into the land, what he calls the rebels among you. Now skip over to Jeremiah chapter 3. And this is picking up on the same period of time. Jeremiah chapter 3. Yep. And look what they're going to be called to do. I'm getting there, Butchie. Verse 12. Go and proclaim these words towards the north and say, return thou backsliding Israel. So we're talking about the house of Israel again, saith the Lord. And I will not cause mine anger to fall upon you, for I am merciful, saith the Lord, and I will keep anger forever. Only acknowledge thine iniquity that thou hast transgressed against the Lord thy God, and hast scattered thy ways to the strangers under every tree, and ye have not obeyed my voice, saith the Lord. He said, I will forgive you as long as you acknowledge your transgression. Remember what Achan did. Committed an accursed thing. He did acknowledge his transgression. Pick it up in verse 16. And it shall come to pass, when ye be multiplied and increased in the land, in those days, saith the Lord, that ye shall say no more the ark of the Lord, ark of the covenant of the Lord, neither shall it come to mind, neither shall ye remember it, neither shall ye visit it, neither shall that be done any more. Remember when we talked about the putting the 12 stones on the west side of the Jordan, and we said, those 12 stones are there so that you'll remember forever that the Ark of the Covenant stood in the midst of the river, right? That was the whole purpose of those stones, so that you'll know that the Ark of the Covenant stood in the midst of the river. And here it says, and it shall come to pass when you are multiplied and increased in the land in those days, saith the Lord, that you shall no more say the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord. Why not? Because what the Ark of the Covenant represents is going to have been fulfilled. Those 2,000 cubits. Pick it up in verse 24. Now let's pick it up in verse 23. It says, truly in vain is salvation hoped for from the hills and from the multitude of the mountains. Truly in the Lord God is the salvation of Israel. So what that's saying, it's talking about those that are outside the land for 2,000 of years who have been trying to create their salvation, who have tried to do, you know, they had that Jewish belief that if every Jew in the world just didn't sin for one day, that the Messiah would come. And it's never going to happen. Truly in vain is salvation hoped for from the hills and from the multitude of the mountains and so forth. Notice what it says in verse 24. For shame, now I want you to think of these verses in the light of Achan. All right? Notice what it says. For shame hath devoured the labor of our fathers from our youth, their flocks and their herds, their sons and their daughters. We already talked about what that from our youth was. The youth was the youth that crossed over into Gilgal. They remember we said they sang in their youth at the Passover is where they sang in their youth. And here he talks about that very thing. He says, for shame hath devoured the labor of our fathers from their youth. What shame? Achan. Shame. That's where the shame came. Because as soon as you sin, you fall back into shame. And so it says, for shame hath devoured the labor of our fathers from our youth, their flocks and their herds, their sons and their daughters. And what did it say of Achan? Yes, it's the things that he took. And then it mentions their flocks and their herds, and their sons and their daughters. Doesn't mention his wife, doesn't mention his cousins, only mentions these things. And there they are right there. We lie down in our shame, and our confusion covereth us. Remember, he was covered with a heap of stones. For we have sinned against the Lord our God, we our fathers from our youth, even unto this day, and have not obeyed the voice of the Lord God. This is the very feeling that they are having as they're coming back to Israel and recognizing their sin. And they've been that way since the time of Achan. They've been consumed by their shame. And now they're at least willing to recognize that it has been their shame that has done it. Because usually when you try to cover it up, you're trying to cover up that shame. And here it is that they're recognizing what's going on. We're going to pick it up in verse here. You know what? I'm just about out of time. So let me talk to you about how this thing plays out. This is the sequence of events that are being described in Ezekiel 20, Jeremiah 3, and elsewhere. Now we're talking about that 2,000 years, the 2,000 cubits, what goes on. And Brother Jim Coward did a great series called Events Subsequent to the Return of Christ, where he talks about all these verses and how they come together. And here's how it plays out. After the saints are raised and converted, so the saints have been raised at Sinai. You've already had the judgment for all those saints over the centuries. So people like Joshua will have already been raised from the dead. Elijah, John the Baptist. If we're alive when we get there, all those that are there, the judgment day has already taken place in Sinai. We know that happens first, and then after that, they travel up to Jerusalem, right? With the March of the Rainbow Angel, Jesus travels up to Jerusalem, and he goes to Jerusalem, and he appears on the Mount of Olives. So this is after the saints have been converted. Elijah will head out with a contingency of saints to the dispersed house of Israel. That's what's talked about in Ezekiel 20, verse 34. It is there that he will plead to them to return to Israel and accept Jesus as the Messiah. That's mentioned in verse 34 of Ezekiel 20 again. They will travel back to Israel via two routes. And all this, it would be another hour if we went through every single passage of time. But you'll see on this map, you see there's two routes. Here's the Mediterranean Sea in and along here. And there's what they call the Wilderness of the People. And there's this route that goes around this way. And then there's another route that goes around this way. And there's two routes. And each route is representative. The southern route here that brings them across this way and up represents the wilderness wanderings. The northern route here that comes down this way is the path of Abraham from out of Ur of the Chaldees. And so Elijah goes out and he speaks with a contingency of saints. It says, and he will travel back to these two routes, one from the Assyrian lands and the other from Egypt. And you can find that in Isaiah 11, 16, we don't have time to look at. And that's what the two maps represents. There will be a purging of those who refuse to return. We saw that in Ezekiel 20, verse 38, the rebels. And they will arrive together. There, unfortunately, you guys can't see it well. Maybe the people at home can see it better. But what happens is there are, on the east of the Jordan River, one coming down from Haran, just like Jacob did, and the other coming up from the wilderness, just like the children of Israel did, and they arrive in a place. And that place is to the east of the Jordan River. And then remember what we read in Jeremiah about how they come into their land? What they do is they're met there together by a man. And that man is Joshua, the Joshua. And he meets them there to the east of the Jordan River. And he parts the Jordan River. This one goes back, that one goes forward. There's no ark. Doesn't need to be an ark. Remember, we said they'll forget about the ark. Because by this time, Jesus is already in Jerusalem. He's already king in Jerusalem. He is the ark. But they're going to walk across the Jordan River with Joshua. And as they walk across the Jordan River, what are they going to find in the midst of the river? 12 stones that Joshua had put there onto this day. And Joshua will explain to him exactly why he put those stones there thousands and thousands of years before. Because he knew he was coming back. Because when they crossed the river the first time, when you cross the Jordan River, you are going from death into life. You are cutting off mortality. Well, back in Gilgal, they didn't cut off mortality. Now mortality is going to be cut off. Because what they'll do is they'll come across the river. Joshua will explain to them what those 12 stones are all about. And they'll come to the other side of the river, where they'll come into the Valley of Achor. And we know two things about the Valley of Achor. That it's called the Valley of Achor, and it's going to be a valley of hope. What hope? And that there is stones piled up on top of a dead family. How would you ever know where they are? But there's one guy that doesn't know where they are. And that guy is Joshua. You see, at this point, the children of Israel still have a problem. And their problem is what we just read about when it talks about their shame. They still have the problem of shame. Do you ever consider why it says when they come to Jesus and they see him, it says that they mourn? Why do they mourn? Wouldn't you repent, given what it means? They see the holes in his hands and his feet. Wouldn't their first response to be to repent or to feel terrible? And it says that they mourn. And the reason that they mourn is because they will have already repented. Because they repent in the Valley of Hope. because they still had this one thing to learn. And it is that God's mercy is everlasting and complete for those who confess. They are, as they cross over, saying, we have got to go to Jerusalem, and we've got to face the man that we have denied for 2,000 years. How do we ever know he's going to forgive us? How can we be sure that that's going to happen? Because there's a man and his family who were stoned to death, ground to powder, and buried beneath a heap of stones. And there's the guy that knows where those stones are. And those stones are there on to this day. And in this day, it becomes a valley of hope, because Joshua removes those stones. And the man who gave an honest confession of his sins, and his sons and his daughters and his livestock, all come out from those stones. Imagine the power that that will have on the dispersed of Israel as they have to go to Jerusalem to meet their Lord. And this is what it says in Zechariah. In Zechariah 9, it talks just about the lesson that they learn. And it says this: and the Lord their God shall save them in that day as the flock of his people. Remember, there's going to be flocks in the Valley of Hope. For they shall be as the stones of a crown, lifted up as an ensign upon his land. For how great is his goodness, and how great is his beauty. And that has been at the heart, I hope, of everything we've talked about for these six classes. Is that at the heart of everything is God's love, God's mercy, and the redemption that we have through the Lord Jesus Christ. And we all need that same Redeemer. And we all need to lay aside the shame and the understandable, sincere shame that we feel because we struggle with sin, and recognize, no matter how we struggle with sin, that God will always forgive us if we give an honest confession of our sins. And if we always recognize that he himself bore our sins in his body on that tree, that we, being dead to sins, might live unto righteousness, and that it is through his stripes that we are healed. And that's the message of these classes and unto this day. Now, the interesting thing is, when I did these classes in a Sunday school class, I almost did them completely separate. I just, from time to time, I would go and look at another one, and then if we had a day where I needed to fill in, I'd bring up another one. There was absolutely no continuity to looking at these verses, other than the fact that I thought, well, they must mean something. And then I decided to put them together on a series of classes. And when I put them together on a series of classes, every single class intertwines with every other class. Why? Because it's all the same message. It's all the same thing. Whether it's onto this day, it's all there in 2 Timothy, where it says, all scripture is profitable for God, profitable for all things, because it's all meshes and harmonizes together. And we have this incredible day coming when the Lord Jesus Christ returns, and we look at the judgment day, and we can be fearful of it. And yet when we consider the story of Achan, we have nothing to be afraid of, if we simply are honest with God and recognize that through Christ we are healed.
BibleTruthAndProphecy.com is a worldwide collaboration by Christadelphians to help promote the understanding of God's Word to those who are seeking the truth about the human condition and God's plan and purpose with this earth and with mankind upon it. Bible Truth and Prophecy is part of a wider set of online resources provided by Christadelphianvideo.org. For establishing just how far removed the true Christian teaching of the first century apostles is from that taught by mainstream Christendom today. BibleTruthAndProphecy.com is very much a standalone website, but benefits from our vast network of sites and resources and social media. Here are just a few of the things that BibleTruthAndProphecy.com offers. We have a good number of written articles supplied to us from brothers from all over the globe. These deal with first principle issues, creation versus evolution, the inspiration of the Bible, and so much more. We have a whole section of video study series. These are studies that have been posted onto our YouTube channel, but because of the difficulty of the search feature within YouTube, we have chosen to host on Bible Truth and Prophecy. So now, every video you search for within the site, you can be guaranteed that it will be of a Christadelphian nature. We also have a preaching video section, where any ecclesia is invited to download and use or embed these videos within their own ecclesial websites. We also have an exhortation service, where we produce two or three exhortations per week, which we then circulate to brethren and sisters in isolation. We also have an ever-growing list of approved Christadelphian sites. We also have a page of live news feeds, so you can keep up to date with all the breaking news as it happens. We also have a section for the daily readings. Each day at around midnight, we publish all three of the daily readings. And then later on in the day, we publish Thought for the Days, often based on all three portions of the daily readings. Within each daily reading post, there is also a link to enable you to have the Bible chapter read to you directly. We also feature Bible in the News videos, videos which we have produced from the Bible in the News website. We also feature Brother Don Pierce's milestone snippets, which come out approximately three times a week. We also feature Andy Walton's weekly World Watch and other commentaries and analysis from other brethren on world news events. You can also subscribe to the blog and be notified of posts as they happen in real time, and also subscribe to the weekly newsletter, which is provided by christadelphianvideo.org. Every page and post on the site has the facility to be able to leave a comment or make an observation, so please take advantage of this and let us know what you think of the site.